So friends, good afternoon to everyone. We are very happy to announce that today Professor Priyambada Sarkar is going to deliver the second lecture of our series as invited by the Esteemed Institute. I'm very happy on behalf of the Institute to welcome you all to this lecture. And I welcome Professor Priyambada Sarkar to deliver this second series of my lecture here. I would not, of course, repeat her introduction and standing in the academic sphere. She has been the professor of philosophy in Calcutta University, and she has largely been invited to different parts of the world to deliver various lectures from her specialized subject. And she completed her PhD from King's College, London, during the period 1982-1986. She has a large number of contributions in the academic field, including edited and written books and publication of various articles in national and international journals. So I would not go into detail to repeat what she exactly is, but I'm very happy again on behalf of the Institute and our society to welcome Professor Sarkar. My friends, fellows, national fellows, and officers and employees of this Institute to this very esteemed lecture. With these few words, I once more welcome Madam Sarkar, please. Thank you very much.
First of all, I'd like to thank the organizers, the director, secretary, all the officials and staff of the Indian Institute of Advanced Study, fellows and associates, visiting professors, all. You have given me this opportunity to share my thoughts with you all. And as it is a continuation of my earlier lecture, I'd like to repeat a few words of my first lecture. I have discussed in my earlier lecture that spirituality and religion, although seem to be inseparably intertwined with each other, still it has recently been separated. They have recently been separated from each other. They are polarized as institutionalized religion versus personal spirituality, substantive religion versus functional spirituality, negative religiousness versus positive spirituality. People appear to reject traditional, organized religion in favor of an individualist spirituality, and which gives importance to individual, personal, mystical experiences of the interconnectedness of the universe. In my last lecture, while we are discussing the journey of life of Rabindranath Tagore, we found the following strands of spirituality that which is evident in Tagore's journey of life. First one was aversion to institutionalized religion, second religion of an artist, feelings of interconnectedness with the universe, closeness to God and Lord of life, and experiencing the mystical. Now, today I'll talk about Wittgenstein, an epoch-making analytic philosopher of the 20th century. For the uninitiated, I'd like to say a few words about his philosophy. Otherwise, it will be difficult for others to appreciate the content of my lecture. Now, Ludwig Joseph Johann Wittgenstein, 1889-1951, he was a student of aeronautical engineering in the University of Manchester, and later he studied mathematical logic and foundations of mathematics in the University of Cambridge under the tutelage of Barton Russell and G.E. Moore. The world recognizes him to be a philosopher bringing out two revolutions in the realm of philosophical thinking. First, by authoring the first book, Tractatus Logico-Philosophicus, a treatise on philosophical logic and philosophical investigations. These two books discuss problems of logic, language, propositions, the theory of meaning, and hardly contain remarks on religion. To be precise, in his early work, there are only four paragraphs. In fact, it is a book which consists of numbered paragraphs. And there are only four paragraphs, of which three are meant to prove a point of logic. So there is only one paragraph about God and religion. That paragraph says that God does not reveal himself in the world. That is, God is not in the world. Not only that, for early Wittgenstein, religion belonged to the domain of nonsense, and of which one should remain silent. He used to believe in his earlier years that all philosophical problems arise only because we do not understand the logic of language. The nature of philosophical problems are such that the problem doesn't get resolved. Plato discussed with the problem of universals. In 2015, the same problem is getting discussed in philosophy. If the problem is genuine, then there must be a genuine solution. If we do not find solution, then we'll have to find problems in the problem itself. So where does the problem lie? It lies in misunderstanding the logic of our language. So if we understand the logic of our language, then we can resolve philosophical problems. Now, to understand the logic of our language, he wanted to distinguish between things which can be stated sensibly and which cannot. He distinguished between sense and nonsense in language. This distinction between sense and nonsense is, you can look at the diagram, that there is sensible and nonsensible. What are the sensible propositions? Those propositions which say something about the world. Those propositions which describe facts of the world, which describe events of the world, that is empirical propositions, that is which covers all scientific propositions. So these are all sensible propositions. So all those propositions which do not say anything about the world, about the facts or events of the world, they are all nonsense, nonsensible. And under the head of nonsense, we can find that logic, mathematics, ethics, aesthetics, religion, metaphysics, all come under the heading of nonsense because they actually do not state anything about the world. So the criterion of sensicality in the Tractatus Logico-Philosophicus leaves all these discourses as nonsensical. Now, although he has distinguished between this sense and nonsense, such distinction has already been done by a group of philosophers called logical positivists. Those logical positivists used to treat all these discourses which do not state anything about the world and which do not fall into the belong to the category of scientific propositions, they are all nonsense. In the sense, they are of no use. They should be like, one can put it into flames, all these discourses. But when Wittgenstein uses the word nonsense, he did not use the term in the way a logical positivist would regard these discourses as nonsense. He said in his lecture, and often when people mistook him as a proponent of logical positivism, he wrote to one of his friends, architect friend, that all that really matters in human life is precisely what, in his view, we must be silent about. What are the things that we must be silent about? All those discourses of ethics, aesthetics, metaphysics, religion, that one should not talk about. Which probably I have not said it earlier, that this distinction is, he did this distinction in order to maintain that what we can sensibly say about all those things which describe about the world. And the other things which come under the heading of nonsensible, they cannot be uttered sensibly in language. So one should not talk about them. One should rather keep mum, so that philosophical problems and confusions would not arise. So this is a famous saying of Wittgenstein, that what can be said clearly. And what we cannot talk about, we must pass over in silence. So these are the discourses which one must be silent about. But at the same time, he realizes that all that really matters in human life is precisely what, in his view, we must be silent about. So he, in fact, is not pejorative about these discourses. And he says, he explains the meaning of nonsensical. He said that these nonsensical expressions were not nonsensical because I had not yet found the correct expressions, but that their nonsensicality was their very essence. Ethics, so far as it springs from the desire to say something about the ultimate meaning of our life, the absolute good, the absolute valuable, can be no science. What it says does not add to our knowledge in any sense, but it is a document of a tendency in the human mind, which I personally cannot help respecting deeply, and I would not for my life ridicule it. So these are nonsensical expressions, all right. They cannot be stated sensibly in language, all right. But he said that they display, they manifest a noble tendency, a human tendency to cross beyond the boundary, to cross beyond the boundary of finiteness, of limitedness. And he cannot ridicule all these things. Now, we know from his letters to his friend, Paul Engelman, that for him, poetry is a mode of keeping silent. And he wanted to treat the Tractatus as a literary work. Clearly, for him, all these art forms can express what philosophy cannot say. The Tractatus wants to convey through language its boundary, its limit, and also, in a paradoxical sense, a glimpse of what lies on the other side of the boundary. The Tractatus shows on the other side of the boundary are the realm of values, the domain of God, meaning of life and the world. Regarding all these things, Ali Wittgenstein opines, philosophers should remain silent. It serves two purposes at the same time. On the one hand, the critics will not be able to formulate their criticisms, for if they want to do that, they will fall into the trap of uttering nonsense. On the other hand, philosophers will also not be able to offer arguments for religion or the domain of values. This is an important point. I'll come back to it later. Now, hence I think, along with Engelman, that there is no paradox in Wittgenstein's characterization of religion as nonsensical and his admonition to silence at the end of the book. Wittgenstein had deep reverence for metaphysics, religion, and other nonsensical discourses. In fact, he had lifelong interest in all those things of which one must be silent about. That he had deep reverence is evident in various textual remarks, personal letters, and other remarks found in autobiographical literature. He said in the preface of his book, he wrote, one of these books he has not written posthumously from his class notes and from his lecture notes. His students had published all these notes as books. One is Philosophical Remarks. He said, this book is written to the glory of God. And in 1930, while discussing Sleeks and other philosophers' criterion of moral goodness, Wittgenstein stated that an action is good if it is what God wills. He chose this criterion as superior to the rationalistic criterion that a good action is good in itself, and if God wills it, it is because it is good and not vice versa. And again, he told Drury, his friend and a student, that I'm not a religious man, but I cannot help seeing every problem from a religious point of view. So such remarks motivate one to explore Wittgenstein's remarks on religion, to inquire into his religious point of view. Now, what should we do? Shall we take recourse to his biography or his biographical remarks Or shall we dive deep into the texts, into the philosophical texts he writes? Now, I have used for this project, I've used biographical studies of Wittgenstein by his student and friend Drury, Brian McGuinness, Ray Monk. Now, there are two views. One philosophical view is, one might object, Wittgenstein's personal opinions might be extremely fascinating, but it is no part of his philosophical approach to prescribe such a faith. Hence, one should restrict oneself only to his philosophical writings to form an opinion about the religious and not to his biographical details. On the other hand, we find references to people who think that the study of a man's life will help us to understand his work in philosophy. What to do? Better to find out what Wittgenstein thinks about this. So I quote that he writes in one of his posthumously published books, Culture and Value, "The greatness or triviality of a piece of work depends on where the man who made it was standing. The greatness of what a man writes depends on everything else he writes and does. Hence, to find out where Wittgenstein was standing when he made such remarks on religion, we would rather explore his life's journey as far as his religious beliefs and feelings are concerned." Now, a journey from the religious to the spiritual. Now, he was born in a family of assimilated Jews. Assimilated Jews means he had three grandparents who were Jews. Others are not. Some were baptized as Roman Catholic. And some are even were Protestant, so they were mixtures, they were assimilated. And he was never a practicing Jew. As a child, he was baptized in a Roman Catholic church and received formal instruction in Roman Catholicism. We also find a reference of young Ludwig lying about his Jewish ancestry for getting admission to a Viennese gymnasium club, which was restricted to those of Aryan origin. He was very keen. He wanted to be admitted to that club. So he lied about his ancestors. He said, "No, only one of my ancestors' grandparents were Jews," just to get himself admitted to that gymnasium. Later he talked about it. Later he kind of confessed about this lie. But by the time Wittgenstein grew up and got admitted to his school, high school, he had lost his faith in Christianity. We learned from his biographers that his loss of faith was partially due to the influence of his father and elder sister, Margaret Stoneborough. When Ludwig confided about his loss of faith to Margaret, she instructed him to read Schopenhauer's The World as Will and Representation. She thought this book would be appealing to an adolescent who had lost his faith in religion. Now, that is why when Russell met Wittgenstein before First World War, he found him to be a fierce critic of religion. But around 1911-12, Wittgenstein had a mystical experience while enjoying a play in Vienna. It was a mediocre play by a mediocre artist. But the narration of the artist that, "I'm absolutely safe, nothing can happen to me," struck Wittgenstein powerfully. And so he told Malcolm, he's another student, he saw for the first time the possibility of religion. Major changes regarding his views about God and living the life of a spirit took place only during the war. During the First World War, he was working there as a volunteer. He was captivated by the enemies and he was sent to prison. And Wittgenstein had to go through immense physical and mental torture. And at the time he used to write diaries. So just one example from his diaries. Suddenly woke about 1 a.m. called for by the lieutenant who says, I must go to the searchlight straight away. Straight, no getting dressed. I ran to the bridge, almost naked. Icy wind, rain. I was certain I was going to die on the spot. Turned on the searchlight, went back to get dressed. It was a false alarm. I was frightfully agitated and groaned audibly. I felt the terrors of war. During this time, he began reading Tolstoy's Gospels in brief, and within a couple of days felt that he was drawing great profit from it. He was moved by the Christianity found in Dostoevsky as well. We find reflections of these ideas in his remarks made in Wartime Diary in 1914 and also in his notebooks 1914 to 16. Now, this spell of Tolstoyan Christianity received a mild blow in 1914 December when he bought the 8th volume of Nietzsche's collected works. So you can well imagine how his faith, how his devotion got a blow from Nietzsche. But still, he stuck to his belief in Tolstoyan Christianity. But after the end of August 1916, Ludwig came to Olmutz and got himself involved with the Jewish circle with the intention of finding out a self-made religion, an ethical equivalent of Christianity. Members of the Olmutz circle used to read the Bible, chiefly the New Testament, together. It is evident in the remarks of notebooks of this period that he had a feeling that he is hiding something. He's hiding something from others. Maybe it was his Jewish identity, and he felt that he was allowing people to think of him as an aristocrat, when in fact he was a Jew. That is, he was trying to find out his roots in Judaism. In conversation with Rudy, Wittgenstein claimed that my thoughts are 100% Hebraic. And later in 1936-37, he confessed that he lied at that time, that one of my grandparents is a Jew, while three of his grandparents were Jews. Now, whether he was a Jew, that is a real field of controversy. Like Raymond, his biographer, Raymond presents Wittgenstein as briefly attracted to using anti-Semitic expressions in the early 1930s, but only as a way of thinking about his own failings. McGinnis contests this general idea that he was a Jew. And Labrow emphasized how Judaic thought finds expression in some central themes of Wittgenstein's thinking. Now, there's a huge controversy whether he should be regarded as a Jew or not, whether he should be regarded as a Catholic Christian or not, without going into the controversy. Whether one should regard Wittgenstein as a Jew or a Catholic, I would like to point out that the following four strands of spirituality is evident in his journey of life pictured above. Now, from the whatever we have learned from his journey of life, we find, to be precise, we cannot really label Wittgenstein to be a member of any organized institutional religion. He got attached to Christianity at some point of his life, while he went to Olmos to find out his roots in Judaism at some other time. But his experiments were short-lived. Wittgenstein was not a Catholic. He said on a number of occasions, both in conversations and in his writings, that he could not bring himself to believe the things that Catholics believe. He said, it is a dogma of the Roman Church that the existence of God can be proved by natural reason. Now this dogma would make it impossible for me to be a Roman Catholic. Philosophers and theologians offer cosmological, teleological, ontological, and other arguments for the existence of God. Wittgenstein was against such rational argumentation for the existence of God. For him, God is beyond such rationalization. He writes, a proof of God's existence should really be something by which one could convince oneself of God's existence. The believers who have provided such proofs have wanted to give their belief an intellectual analysis and foundation, although they themselves would never have come to believe through such proofs. Whenever anyone believes in anything, in God or in spirit or in anything, or has faith in something, he doesn't acquire it by means of argumentation. So you cannot reach there by means of rational argumentation. So he rejected evidences and arguments for the existence of God. He abhors the idea that a philosophical justification for religious beliefs is necessary for those beliefs to be given any credence. Norman Malcolm also reported that he could not have reconciled himself to any of the Christian denominations with their required assent to various dogmas. For Wittgenstein, historical records are not relevant for one's belief in God or religion. It did not really matter whether Jesus was a historical figure or not. We have ample evidence of historical records and philosophical arguments for Judaism and Christianity in the history of philosophy and theology. Both Judaism and Christianity are institutionalized religions where we find respective creeds, rituals, and dogmas. He was disinclined to adhere to any conventional religious tradition. That is why when Drury, his student, his dear student and friend, once time he came, he asked Wittgenstein that I want to be a clergy. Then he said, no, no, I cannot approve. I'm afraid that one day that collar would choke you. That means the collar of a clergy would choke you. He seems to have objected to the narrowness of the Anglican clergy, and the above discussion shows why Wittgenstein told Drury that I am not a religious man. By this he wanted to get across the idea that he does not believe in any religion in the sense of an institutionalized doctrine or creed. Rather, he stressed on spiritual purity and ethical living as fundamental to religious belief. So the next point is closeness to God and ethical living. The ideal of ethical living attracted Ludwig right from his early years. He was a son of a very rich industrialist in Vienna. So he inherited a huge property after his father's death. And he didn't accept that property and money on the ground that I have not earned it, I don't have the right. So he distributed it, he made a trust to help after the World War, this poets, artists, writers, they had this paucity of funds So he created a fund for them and distributed some money for his sisters and others. And he used to live a very simple life, almost like the life of a sannyasi. The ideal for Wittgenstein, the salient point of religion is that it is engaged with moral activities. He believes perhaps one could convince someone of God's existence through a certain kind of upbringing by shaping his life in such and such a way. That means by a certain kind of ethical upbringing. Throughout his life, Wittgenstein was concerned with ethical action, which he used to term as decent behavior. That's why he said, if you and I are to live religious lives, it must not be that we talk a lot about religion, but that our manner of life is different. You don't have to talk a lot about religion, about religion, about rituals, about creeds, about other things. Only thing, you will have to behave differently. You will have to act in a moral manner. It is my belief that only if we try to be helpful to other people, will see you in the end find your way to God. To maintain a religious life does not even require churches to fall back on. For Wittgenstein, religion of the future then will be an ethical religion. Ethics and religion are intimately related, and in a strange way, for him, ethics and religion are intertwined. He said, something is good if it is divine. And he asked, how can a man be happy at all? Since he cannot ward off the misery of this world, the only life that is happy is the life that can renounce the amenities of the world. And we learn from his biography how he himself lived such happy life by renouncing the amenities of the world. Now, he believed that decent behavior as ethical living leads one towards his own inner God. He advises, don't depend on circumstances. Make sure that your religion is a matter between you and God only. That God in early Wittgenstein is related to one personally is evident in his equation of God with the meaning of life and also with the meaning of the world. And he ties this with the simile of God as Father. God is closely related to us as Father. For him, such bonding and closeness to God can be grasped not by reasoning, but by experiences or feelings of the mystical, which he expresses as how extraordinary that something should exist, how extraordinary that the world should exist. So the next strand of spirituality is experiencing the mystical. The mystical is related to a particular type of viewing the world. To view the world sub specie eterni is to view it as a whole, a limited whole. Feeling the world as a limited whole, it is this that is mystical. He clarifies, it's not how things are in the world that is mystical, but that it exists. It is interesting to note that this particular example of the mystical, I wonder that the world exists, serves for him as an example of absolute value judgment on the one hand, and absolute aesthetical judgment on the other. And an analysis of the statement will reveal in a moment that it is actually a statement of religious experience. It is the experience of seeing the world as a miracle. Now, to him, wondering at the existence of the world is an experience par excellence. I'm sure that you all are having questions. How can I wonder that the world exists be an ultimate value statement, ethical statement, or aesthetical statement, or religious statement? In fact, when do we wonder we wonder at some when something happens extraordinarily. Like suppose if it happens that sweets rain in the Diwali night, that is something extraordinary. If we find that a baby is born with four heads, that is extraordinary, and we wonder at such happenings. So when do we wonder? That means the extraordinary circumstances. So if we negate it, then we get the ordinary statement. Now, when I'm saying I wonder that the world exists, I cannot even negate it. How can I negate it? Because I'm in this world. So this is from ordinary point of view, from the ordinary usage of language, this use of the term wonder is misleading. It doesn't fit in with our ordinary use of wonder. So this is something which is saying that why can't we express it in our ordinary language? Because it is beyond our ordinary language. It is something that we cannot grasp with our ordinary limited capacities. So why is this, I wonder that the world exists? It's a kind of mystical feeling. When you have this extraordinary feeling that there is no gap between you and the world, you become the world and the world becomes you. It's a kind of, it's a holistic grasp of the whole world. That is something, why I'm finding it difficult to make you understand. Because this is not something which describe the events of the world. Because it is talking about the whole world, not something which is in the world. So this is something which is absolutely absolute value judgment, because relative value we can understand, but absolute value is beyond our comprehension. And it's a paradigm example of aesthetic judgment, because that is where beauty lies, when there is no difference and the whole world is me and I am the whole world. So this is a kind of experiencing the mystical that he talks about. And how can I have such an experience? Here he talked about viewing subspici eternally. You can translate it as viewing from eternity. And viewing from eternity, how can we understand this viewing from eternity? Suppose when you are viewing something from a height, say from the window of a plane. So from there, you see the whole landscape as equal. When you come near it, you find differences. But when you see from above, everything is equal. So when you see the thing from eternity, then there are no distinction. It's a not a very good way to explain, but I'm trying to explain because I can guess from the gestures that it's not getting transferred. Now, when one contemplates a particular thing aesthetically, or from eternity, it becomes the whole world. Similarly, if one views the world ethically, then also it waxes and wanes as a whole. It becomes a completely different world. Thus, viewing from eternity enables one to see and know that each one of us belongs to the world as a whole, where everybody is on the same level. Now, this is interconnectedness with the universe. Now, in some of his cryptic passages in notebooks, he says there really is only one world soul, which I, for preference, call my soul, and as which alone I conceive what I call the souls of others. What do I know about God and the purpose of life? I know that the world exists. Then there is this fundamental remarks. God is how things stand. How things stand is God. Now here seems to be an inconsistency. We find an inconsistency. Because before I told you that he has one remark in the Tractatus where he says God does not reveal himself in the world. So God is not in the world. And here in these paragraphs in notebooks he is saying God is how things stand. And how things stand is God. It sounds some pantheistic manner of describing the world. Now how to negotiate this inconsistency? For me, the remarks from notebooks, though sound like those of pantheism, are not to be treated as pantheism proper. As Wittgenstein here is talking about the view that one can have only when he or she views the world from eternity. We have discussed earlier that viewing from eternity connects ethics and aesthetics with God, the sense of life, the meaning of the world. It helps us to see God or meaning of life and the world in every mundane object or fact. This is another way of saying God is how things stand. Thus, the world that he was talking about as the totality of facts, which doesn't have God in it, because God is not a fact of the world. So God is not there. So the world as a totality of facts, as being contingent and relative, is devoid of value and significance. So it seems that there are two worlds, the world of sensible sentences, the world of facts, and the world of values, meaning of life, meaning of world, ethics, aesthetics, religion, metaphysics, all are in another world and they are not in this world. So there are two worlds. Now here it seems that he doesn't want to make it two world theory. What he wanted to maintain is that however contingent the facts of the world are, they somehow reveal the necessary, the sublime. This world and this life is not totally insignificant or devoid of value for the early Wittgenstein, as the significant and the insignificant, the necessary and the contingent, the sublime and the trivial are intertwined with each other. The doctrine of showing, he says that what cannot be said can be shown. Suppose you are angry with someone. You cannot tell him, you don't have to tell him always that I'm angry. Suppose you are bored, you don't have to tell that I'm bored with your lecture. You can show it. So it's not mandatory that everything will have to be said. It shows itself. So that is what Wittgenstein said in the Tractatus, that what you cannot say, you can show. So the totality of facts, the totality of world shows that there is a world of values and they are not distinct, they are intertwined with the world of facts. So the world and this life is not totally insignificant or devoid of value. As the significant and the insignificant, the necessary and the contingent, the sublime and the trivial are intertwined with each other. The doctrine of showing reveals in an indirect way what is not in the world, hence cannot be represented in ordinary language. He used to think that this kind of viewing the world from eternity is viewing the world aright, where the interconnectedness of God, the ethical, the aesthetical, the religious man and the world is manifested. Now, I'd like to conclude by pointing out that the journey on the part of Wittgenstein was thus from the outer to the inner, from the religious to the spiritual, to one's own religion, where there is no formal creed, ritual and sermons. So now I can explain the original puzzling statement that I'm not a religious man because I don't belong to, I don't believe in any organized, institutionalized religion. But I cannot help looking at things from a religious point of view, that is from the point of view of eternity, from viewing the world from subspecie eterni. And I can feel that there are no distinctions. The world of facts and the world of values, they are intertwined with each other. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Sarkar, for your excellent lecture. In the lecture, she has not only given certain biographical references to Wittgenstein's life, but also has gone into the theoretical content of this lecture, which consists in the four strands that she has identified. One is the aversion to institutionalized religion, the closeness to God and ethical living, experience in the mystical, and interconnection with the universe. I think these four points really summarize Wittgenstein's philosophy of religion and spirituality. The essence of this lecture can be summed up like saying how Wittgenstein journeyed from the outer to the inner, from the religious to the spiritual. So she has really given us an insight into the very noble life and philosophy of Ludwig Wittgenstein. So now the lecture is open for discussion. So may I invite questions and queries on this lecture? Professor Narayan.
Thank you, Professor, for a very informative lecture. I'm in several minds. I'm not sure whether I'm expressing it correctly, but there are a number of questions that came up as part of listening to you. One is, even as we accept the possibility that there was an attempt within Wittgenstein to kind of negotiate between the two worlds, the world of objects, of facts, of reality as that which can be represented through language, not represented, that which can be addressed through language, and the other world, which, as he says, is better to be silent about, which you cannot properly negotiate through language. My wonder is, especially in his earlier work and probably later too, he was concerned primarily also with the limits of language. As he says, the limits of the language is the limits of the world. And that language was not representational at all in his conception. One, in terms of language games, and on another level, in terms of language not really expressing objects or facts, but in terms of whether the language agrees or disagrees with the arrangement, the statement itself. So in that sense, the limits of language is one aspect, in which case he was basically suggesting that the other experience, if it exists at all, that is the experience, the mystical experience, or the experience of God, or the experience of ethics, etc., is basically not the province of language at all. Where, in a certain manner of speaking, he was trying to define the province of philosophy as something that does not really connect with the province of theology or religion or ethics, etc. So that is one question there, where he basically brings in a cleavage between the two. The second problem that I thought was, listening to your lecture, whether he was actually using a set of words which in other discourses is being used, were being used in a different manner. For example, when he talks about ethical action not belonging to any creed, but what matters, that is what actually matters in religious life, in a non-institutional kind of idea, isn't it a different kind of humanism that you find there? A humanism which probably lost its way in the 19th century and became the butt of ridicule at a certain point of time, especially coming from Marxist critiques, etc. And where here it is an attempt to recover that humanism on the one hand, and on the other, when you talked about the subspecie eterni, the eternal view, and where it is not how things are in the world, but that it exists, the question of wonder. I can't help but be reminded of Wordsworth, who said that even the meanest flower can give you thoughts that lie too deep for tears. There is a deep romantic, even verging on the environmental consciousness, which when we look at deep environmental thinking in the current period right now, there seems to be a conception of the human being as not something separate, apart, the anthropocentric view, but someone who is implied within the environment itself. So I wonder if two things, whether he was consciously trying to avoid the use of those terminology, which probably is expected in other discourses like literature or the environmental consciousness of that time, or whether he was trying to create a new vocabulary for philosophy.
So, these three questions. Yeah. Now, the first question about the limits of language, that I would like to restrict it within his works, within his early works. I do not want to extend it to the language game analogy. Now, of course, in this early period, his sole aim was to draw a limit to thought. He said that in order to resolve philosophical problems, what we need is to draw a line of thought, like what can be sensibly thought and what cannot be. And that cannot be done, because if you want to draw a boundary to thought, then you will have to think the unthinkable. Because whenever you draw a boundary, you immediately know what is on the other side of the boundary. So if you want to draw a boundary of what is thinkable, you are bound to think the unthinkable. So that cannot be done. That is why he thought of limiting the language. You can limit the language in the sense that you can limit the sensible language. On the other side, there is nonsense. Like on this side, there is sensible language, and on the other side, there is nonsense. We can talk about it. There's no contradiction here.
Can I just interject and ask, when this question of sense, is it to be taken as transcendental, or is it a concept connected with language itself?
Oh, it because he wrote it in German, he used the word Sinn
as
sense. And there, when he is using these empirical statements, he is using the German word Sinn voll, like it's full of sense. But when he is using when he is discussing about these nonsense, it's a huge discourse. All these logic, metaphysics, ethics, aesthetics, religion, all goes to this part. There he uses two German words. One is Sinn los and another is Unsinn. Now, when he is using the word Sinn los only in cases of logic and mathematics. Logic and mathematics are senseless in the sense that they do not say anything about the world, they are abstractions. But apart from logic and mathematics, there are all these discourses. These discourses are sometimes he uses the word unseen, sometimes unsinning, and he in his lecture on ethics, he explains it in this way that these are attempts to express what is inexpressible. So here you get this sense of transcendental sense in Zen when he uses the term unseen. And here he attempts to express the inexpressible. Like, as I had difficulty in explaining this, I wonder that the world exists, because this is something which is inexpressible. But what I'm trying to do, what Wittgenstein is trying to do, is to attempt to express the inexpressible. So it amounts to this kind of nonsense. So this goes to this transcendental kind of nonsense. And he wanted to, like, the cleavage is there. Because this cleavage is his distinction between saying and showing. You can say all those things which are in the world. And you cannot say all those things which are not in the world sensibly. But how do you know that there are things? Because these things show, they manifest, they reveal. So these things are there. That's how I understand. The second one, I agree with you wholly that this ethical living and everything was related with humanism, and because this he has in two world wars, and at that time people, they all were thinking that we are all bankrupt, morally bankrupt. So in that way he wanted to boost morality, or he thought that this is the way to proper religion. And the third one?
The romantic environmental discourse.
Oh, right. I agree with you, because you know, what I wanted to do in the course of this lecture, in my last lecture I talked about Tagore and showed that these strands of spirituality is evident in Tagore's writings. And did it there, and then in the next lecture I'll show how these converge. And he was really interested in the poems of Tagore, not only poems. One of his plays, The King of the Dark Chamber, he liked it so much, he used to distribute it to the philosophers of Vienna circle. And he thought that somehow the sense of the drama is not clear to others because there is a translation, because the thing, original thing, I'm not getting the original thing. So he attempted to translate this Raja. So in fact you were right. He thought that philosophy should be done in the way a literature, a piece of literature is written. And he believed that Tractatus, I just mentioned that it's a kind of poetry. And he sent it to a German literary journal to publish it. And he had a feeling, he said that poets and philosophers, normally they are they're separated from each other, but it should not be the case. So the way you have brought out Shakespeare's line, the same way Tagore also has written about the wonder that the world exists.
I just have a small interjection, whether we can call it a revival of humanism, that has to be really debated. But one thing is very clear, he is putting man not at the center of the universe. He is giving the world of values, which he calls sometimes divine, at the forefront of his universe. So in that sense, it may not be a revival of the materialistic humanism. Maybe you can call it a spiritualized humanism. Then in that case, of course, he was giving a new definition of man. man as an aspiring individual, not as an individual who is confined to the world, but who wants to cross the limits of the world, or such a man he is imagining. Perhaps that may be a romantic man. He is, in a, just as in Hegel, for example, you are crossing the limits of the ordinary mind and looking towards a better world. So that way we can say that he is in a romantic frame of mind. Otherwise he would not have called that everything that man he writes is for the glory of God. So in 20th century, after much materialism which has gone into Western civilization, he could not have appealed to the notion of God. No.
What are the ways in which ethics and religion are intertwined, as Wittgenstein says, and what are the ways and the possibility of extricating ethics from religion?
Like there's one point on this strands of spirituality, that is ethical living, and I know his kind of religion is not like institutionalized religion. It's a kind of ethical religion. And you know that ethics constituting the religion, this is not as an idea, this is not foreign, this idea is not foreign to us, because think of Jainism, think of Buddhism, they don't have gods, because those systems, their religion is kind of ethical religion. And he, for him, whatever is good, good in the sense, that is divine. Now, whenever he's using the word good, this good he's not using in the ordinary sense. Why? Because you suppose you are talking about a good student. So whenever you talk about a good student, you give some criteria for a good student. Tell me, what are the criteria that you regard for treating someone as a good student?
No, I'm trying to understand.
I'll come to your point. Give me the criteria which you will regard, like a good student should have the properties, the attributes, the characteristic features.
That would be relative.
That would be relative, yes. That would be, suppose you say sincerity, intelligence, hard work. Like someone is sincere, intelligent and hardworking, we call him a good student. So, good is equivalent to property 1 plus property 2 plus property 3. So this is the word good here is relative to the conjunction of three properties. But when he is using this good which is divine, that is not this kind of relative good. That is something absolute. Where there is that is something which is at the same time inexpressible in ordinary language, for which you will have difficulty in understanding it, but at least you can see the difference. That normal good, like the tea is good, pakora is good, that is not as good as divine. But this good, which it treats as absolute value judgment, like I wonder that the world exists. This is something which is absolutely valuable, and this is also kind of religious experience kind of thing. I don't know whether...
So I think her question was whether religion
ethics.
And ethics go together.
Is there the possibility of ethics without religion?
How to extricate ethics from religion, that was your query. Actually, Wittgenstein doesn't believe that ethics has to be liberated from religion. Because he himself says, good is that which is willed by God. So that statement is important. That means God's will is primary than the ethical will.
That's what I want to ask.
Okay.
Strangely indeed, even while Wittgenstein seems to be critiquing established or institutionalized religion, and also the fact that it is probably not possible to talk about, especially when he says that believers, it is a retrospective rationalization that they do, that they don't come to believe through proofs, and they're just providing proofs to other people. There, he's actually on the one hand critiquing institutionalized religion, established religion, as well as the fact that they are discoursing about it, while in fact it is not possible to discourse about it. Now, but then, in the absence of another language with which to speak about it, he has to speak about it, he says it is unspeakable, it is something that you cannot, because it belongs to the sphere of the of nonsense, it is better to be silent about it, but still he has to speak about it. So then he falls back upon the categories which are already available in connection with religious life, in connection with religious discourse, and uses words like God, good, etc. Why, in fact, probably as she suggests, that's what I carry from this, whether in fact his attempt was basically to actually extricate the idea of ethics itself from religion. From religion as we have known it, or as he has known it till that point of time, or even till this point of time.
What I find is that whenever he is talking about ethics and making it identical with aesthetics and religion, he's not talking about the ordinary ethics, like ethics books, right, from the days of sophists, which you all have studied, which can be stated in language. At least in this early phase, he has this thrust on absolute value judgment. When you are talking about this absolute value judgment, then there is no distinction between ethics, aesthetics, and religion.
Of course, he was
transgressing the limits. That is why at the end he says that this is a book of nonsense. He's well aware of this, but he was trying to take it as a ladder.
The point was, when he says good is divine, what sort of conception of good he has? So that he is hinting at. So that could not be free from what we may call religion in the true sense of the term. Not in the institutional form of religion or theological discourse of religion. So by saying that good is divine, and the ethical will is subservient to God's will, thereby he is reinstating religion in a different way. So in that sense, the question of extrication doesn't arise.
There is one thing, if you
allow. This must participate. Yeah, madam, yeah. Professor Singh, yeah.
I don't know for sure, because I read this long time. Hitler and Wittgenstein, they were in the same school and in the same class, probably.
Senior junior.
But they were in the same school, if I rightly remember. So, because you were tracing the biography and you said from the outer to the inner, so how much of this outer really kind of, made him, and of course he was talking about language, the impossibility of conveying something. So we all think in terms of word pictures, and my word picture may not correspond to your word picture, and this leads to misunderstanding and so on. So how much of this moving inwards was a result of this, the biographical, the times that he lived in, his own family background, coming from a very affluent family, and so on. So, I mean, because you were tracing biography and so on, so I was just curious, because it was a very precarious time.
Exactly. It was the time frame is very important.
Very important.
And the situations and the circumstances he had to go through, that is also very important. That's why he had not stuck to any particular theory. He's vacillating. Sometimes he's trying his thing in Christianity, in Judaism, in other forms also. Like he was when he was teaching in Cambridge, at the time one Indian guy, Kanti Shah, he was a student, And once Wittgenstein asked Gandhi, are you a Muslim? Gandhi said, no, I'm Jain. Then Wittgenstein said, I read about Jains. Jain Tirthankars used to meditate on hilltops. Gandhi probably made some, because young Indian guy has made some derogatory hints or something, gestures was not good. Wittgenstein was angry and he said, look, they have created this thing throughout the thousands of years. You might not believe in it, but you cannot show your disrespect to them. That doesn't show the honesty of your thinking. So, you know, he had a kind of reverence to other religions, and he was knowledgeable also. Probably because his situation at the time, I think so.
How was he influenced by Indian tradition?
I somehow find a lot of thing which is common between the philosophy of Tagore and Wittgenstein, but and he was fond of reading his poems and other things also. But you know, I didn't find any reference to say that he was really kind of thing. But I find, so what the way I present it, it's that there are similarities in the structure of thought. I did not say influence.
How is this concept of internal realization of thought?
All these quotations which I showed, it seems it comes from conversations with various students, friends. I think he was talking about inner God. Something which lies within. You don't have to search it in the outside world. And there's no barrier between you and God.
Can there be Indian influence?
I cannot use that influence because I don't have evidence. I don't have evidence.
But two traditions can think likewise.
They know well.
Now they can think likewise.
Many great men think alike. We can say that.
But when one is thinking 2,000 years back, the other is thinking 2,000 years after.
I'll mention this. He was influenced by Schopenhauer. And Schopenhauer was influenced by Indian Vedanta.
That is where I am catching it.
So,
the ideas went to Europe through Schopenhauer. Schopenhauer got it through the Upanishad, which was the Latin translation of Upanishads. And through him, he got the ideas, acquaintance with Indian thought. So, in that sense, you can say indirect influence. Any other question? Otherwise, I will have some doubts about.
I just wanted to say something.
Please then.
Like when you were saying defining that what is good, so there are two options. Good is what God wills. Another is good is what is good, and God wills it because it is good. Of the two, he preferred the first one. He did not accept the second one, the rationalistic interpretation of good. Why? Because if you think about this objective criterion of good, then you will have to give reasonings, then you will have to argue for it. He is against, he is beyond all these things. So there is his kind of ethics. Is a different kind of ethics he's talking about. That's what I think.
So what is the relationship of his philosophy with Plato's idea of good? When Plato is talking about the idea, means he's not talking about religion, but he's talking about the idea of good. And this good is something again absolute. It's the it's absolute good, in which there is an essence to a particular thing, and that's the idea. And I just was wondering, like, where do you see the relationship between Plato's idea and his good?
There are books also coming out, Plato and Wittgenstein. And it's, although he's, you're right, the absolute good, and that is on their top. And but Wittgenstein really didn't talk about another transcendental realm. And people are doing, people are comparing Plato and Wittgenstein. Yes.
Well, related with it, it's like when you're giving his life journey, I find that he's like too much engrossed in the institution of religion. Means, although as you say that he's rejecting the institutionalized religion, that like his discovery means his rejection of being a Jew, adopting Catholicism, then again rediscovering the Jew, being Jew. So like, means somewhere like that, the idea of, that's where my question about Plato comes, because Plato doesn't talk about the idea of good with any religion in mind. It's just an absolute idea of good. So, like,
there's much, much, much difference that there has to be.
No, means my question is like, means he's too much, means the reference point remains some institutionalized religion. Maybe he's in the end, are in the process rejecting that institutionalized religion, but the throughout the journey, it's was it the crisis of religion or was it the pressure of being associated with the religion at that point of time? I was just thinking that it's a pressure to be religious in some way, one way or the other, to be part of this religion or that religion.
Had you been in my earlier lecture, then you might have noticed that Tagore was also for some time he was fascinated by Brahmo Dharma, sometimes Vaishnav Dharma, sometimes and other rituals, Islam, Baul, Sufism, all these things. Sometimes they're going, but these minds, they cannot be restricted. They don't like the idea of getting caught by religious dictates or something. But if you want to come out, definitely you are within something and you want to come out. If you are already out, then there is no question of coming out.
Okay, so I have just a small point. If you talk about two worlds theory, the world which can be represented in language and the other which we cannot, then the question will arise whether he accepts it transcendent world, and to which Chaudhary was referring to, if in Plato the good will be a transcendent good, so it cannot be part of any relativized scheme of things. So in that sense, if we want to draw a similarity between Wittgenstein and Plato, then we have to accept that there is a transcendent world also. Though many people have questioned that very idea, and you seem non-committal to that. But once you accept saying and sowing, if you make a distinction between saying and sowing, then perhaps you are committed, or you are bound to be committed to a world which is not this world, but the transcendent world.
But this is not Plato's transcendent world.
Okay, that's a matter of debate. Plato's transcendental world is not somewhere in the heaven. So it is also something which is spilling out of our ordinary thinking. So that...
But it's so difficult to tie up Plato's theory of good with the particular theories of good, and all these problems are
okay,
there.
Yeah, that's one. About the interpretation of how things stand is God, and God is how things stand. You have rejected the pantheistic interpretation of it, and that is perhaps right. But when he says how things stand, he's again talking of the totality of the world. So things here doesn't mean the objects in the sense he's introducing the Tractatus, but this is in the notebooks. So things are not the objects really, things, the beings, things in the larger sense of the term, the totality of the world. Now if he says that the total world is God, or the totality of the facts and objects constitute God, then is he not very near to pantheism? Of course, pantheism traditionally means God is everywhere. Path means everywhere, and theism, God is everywhere. So it comes closer to that. But if we apply the substrate eternitatis interpretation, then perhaps this will stand to scrutiny and to reason that he is not talking in a pantheistic form, but he is talking of looking at the world from a transcendental point of view as a totality, as a sum totality, and therefore he can call that sum totality God. There is no personal God. In that sense, he is closer to Spinoza in that sense, that the substance is God, and substance is the total universe is in God. So can you find some relation between...
In fact, if I take the remarks, the remarks are blatantly pantheistic.
Yes.
But the problem is that if I take it as an expression of pantheism, then I have difficulty in explaining that God does not reveal himself in
the
world.
Yes.
So this inconsistency...
So notebooks and tractates really
conflict.
Conflict.
So I just, it's my humble attempt to harmonize and to settle this controversy in this way.
Yeah, Professor Narayan, we can carry on.
Isn't there a strain of or a note of non-dualism when Wittgenstein seems to talk about there is only one world, soul, and the only way I can understand is through my own soul? Probably this question gets resolved in a certain way, I would think, because where it's not, even when the idea of an eternal view is brought up, it is still at the same time a view from within, not from without. Because just as his soul is implicated within the world soul, and there is there is identity between the two, when they cease to be the two, then this question of the transcendental world and this world probably also gets resolved. I don't know.
In fact, the problem is, like notebooks, these void soul conception and this pantheistic conception, these are all remarks from the notebooks. And what he did, he took whatever was relevant and consistent, and then from these notebooks he made the tractatus. The tractatus does not refer to these things, like this world soul. And this conception of world soul, that is also very difficult to pinpoint, because he is saying there is no such thing. There is no such thing as the soul or as the self which thinks or entertains ideas. He, in the manner of Hume, he rejects the conception of self in the tractatus. But then again he says, there is a sense in which there can be a metaphysical self and an ethical self. These things are there in the tractatus, but there he did not maintain, mention this world soul. And this ethical self, this willing I, this self is not anyone, not like myself, sir self, other self, not like that. But, this self, if he wills something, the whole world changes. Like if I am positive and I'm helpful to other, that changes, that ethical attitude towards the world changes my world, changes an unhappy world into the happy world. So this is a very, very difficult, very complicated concept of self. Too many selves are there. And this world spirit is there in the notebooks also. So I cannot say anything straight that it will be.
Yeah, what should we learn now? There are one soul or many souls?
Both.
Yeah, or probably no souls.
Or probably no souls.
I think we should not club the two books and justify one and reject the other. Supposing we take the notebook standpoint, that was his question.
No.
If there is a world soul, and my soul cannot be different from the world soul.
Yeah.
So
that,
in that sense, monism follows.
Non-dualism
follows.
That helps in
yeah,
this
that.
Way. But then again, you will be having difficulty in interpreting. There is no such thing as the soul in the
picture. Is different because...
No, these things
such,
are there in
yeah.
the notebooks also.
So notebook's point of view, if we take, you are right in saying that non-dualism will follow. There cannot be many souls. There will be one world soul, of which we will be parts.
I just wonder, I mean, probably there is no connection here, but I think it's also a historical moment because you also have parallel to Wittgenstein, actually in Germany, someone like Walter Benjamin, trying to yoke Hebrew theology with Marxism, where the whole concept of history itself, the Marxist concept of history itself is turned on its head, and where he talks about the angel of history looking it back upon the wreckage that it can see. And where it's Hebrew, Hebraic notion which comes to kind of inform Marxism from within, from inside, totally transforming it, so to speak. So whether, I'm just wondering, because they're not contemporary, strictly speaking, but they occupy the same historical moment, and whether it is a certain attempt in terms of not just categories alone, but in terms of the paradigms of discourse, of philosophical discourse itself, trying to extend the frontiers of what has been there, and where at one and the same time there is an attempt to extricate themselves from the paradigms that already exist, but still lacking the language for the new paradigm to be, where it is that strain which probably, in Benjamin, in Thesis on Philosophy of History, for example, you find that really, you really find that that tension between the two and the attempt to actually, you know, go beyond that. So, I was just wondering.
So one can refer to Rousseau as well, that moment when he is going to talking about the will, the real will and the actual will.
Same way, yeah.
And in that, he's talking about the general will, that how the real wills, the sum total of the real wills is the general will. But then distinguishing between the real will and the actual will.
So, yeah.
That could be like, I'll think about it. These are my, like, I'm gaining this from your comments.
Kind of philosophy of history. I think he had, at least he had made, Wittgenstein made a famous statement in the notebooks that what has I have got to do with history? That means he was looking at a historical point of view. So that was his constant theme. So he was least interested in the history itself. Because if you talk of sub-speaking eternitatis, then he is more concerned with the eternal point of view rather than the historical point of view. So that may be a lacuna, because 20th century is known for its concern with history. And if somebody is trying to recapture history in terms of Judaism, or in Hebrew religion, for example, Marxist history, as you said, one can talk of history really from Wittgenstein's point of view by showing that perhaps man's history is more, as he would have liked to say, more a history as is running on impersonal laws. So that would be also for him a Hebrew kind of notion of history. History is made by God, really. History is not man-made in that sense. So if we reclaim Wittgenstein's philosophy of history, then we may say it is a divinized form of history. So that perhaps could be one way of understanding Wittgenstein's notion of history.
Something like, mine is the only history or something.
Yeah, exactly. Referring to that statement, what have I got to do with history? Mine is the only history. That means it is only suggesting a historical point of view. So the real history is really disregarded. But if we reclaim his notion of history, then it will be a divinized form of history. And that comes closer to his Judaic way of thinking. So in spite of his declaration that he is not a Jew, he is really thinking in a Jewish way.
Yeah.
Huh. There's a funny comment also. And he said, probably said or he wrote it to someone, that all these Jews, they cannot think originally. They always think other things, and I'm also that.
He comes very closer to his Jewish thing.
And he said that
divine command theory comes from really Judaism. And everything is commanded by God. So that is a Judaic way of thinking. So in that, perhaps he could not hide his own Jewish way of thinking.
He said, my writings are
humble. Your title also a Jew, so-called Jew. So,
but the self-mockery is certainly not Jewish at all.
Any other point to be raised? So Nath didn't raise questions.
No questions, but
because you always put many questions. Today you are very. Professor Nath could not raise many questions. And he raises a few more questions. Okay, now I request Professor Nath to propose a vote of thanks.
So, thank you, Professor Sarkar, for your very interesting, informative, and amiable lecture on this very important topic of religion and spirituality with reference to Wittgenstein. We feel we are quite enriched today in our knowledge about a very peculiar kind of modern philosophy. We thank you very much on behalf of the Institute and behalf of the audience. I thank you, Professor Pradhan, for kindly conducting this chair.
Thank you.
And also for making the lecture interesting by explaining so many ways, by explaining so many ununderstood aspects of the lecture. We record our thanks to your kind share and for your kind explanation of the subject. And I also thank all the audience for so mildly listening to this lecture and the other lecture and making the lecture finally a successful one. And finally, I record my thanks to the Institute for giving us the opportunity of listening to such a beautiful lecture. Thank you very much.
ऊपर देख ऊपर उठा